Welcome to this webinar on accessibility and usability for web publications. Our presenter today is Katya, and I'm going to do a great job on her last name. Pereyaslavska is her last name, and she is coming to us from the Association of Research Libraries. She's a visiting program officer there for accessibility and universal design. She has been tasked with raising awareness of inclusive library practices and accessible publishing. She, in her day-to-day role as the accessibility librarian at Scholars Portal in Ontario at the Council of University Libraries, she's been responsible for the development of a service and major research initiatives such as Accessible Content ePortal, which is also known as ACE, the Accessibility Information Toolkit for Libraries, and a report on accessible media. Today she's going to be talking with us about open access and accessibility. Her question is, what is open access if it's not open to all readers? And conversely, what is accessible if only to a small number of readers? So this talk is going to focus on the what if we looked at open access and accessibility and scholarly communications as one as in the same. This webinar will be recorded for viewing later, so we'll be sharing that out with the membership. Sarah will be sharing that out in, Sarah, a few days?
Yep, I usually try to get it up on YouTube within a couple of days.
Okay, and during the session, if you have questions that are really pressing, that are kind of clarification points, please feel free to ask them. Otherwise, Katya asked for kind of general broad questions to be addressed at the end, and there will be time for that. And I will be monitoring the chat box and will be making sure those all get addressed at the end. If you want to go off mute and ask your question out loud, you're welcome to do that as well. All right, with that, I'm going to turn it over to I should also say, I have one last thing to say before I turn it over, that this event is supported by the Library Publishing Coalition, and it is coordinated and sponsored by the Library Publishing Coalition's Professional Development Committee. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Katya.
Thank you very much, Kate. Just wanted to make sure that my audio is working okay. I also wanted to thank everyone this afternoon who was able to join us. I know there are a lot of really exciting PD opportunities that come up through different organizations, and it's really hard to keep track on what, you know, kind of grabs your attention. So I really appreciate everyone who was able to join. So during this webinar, I will focus on what it means for institutions of higher learning to engage in open access library publishing through the lens of producing accessible content. As Kate mentioned, this is my particular area of work. I am the accessibility librarian at Scholars Portal, which is a part of Ontario Council of University Libraries. And my day-to-day work includes a lot of advocacy work on behalf of libraries, reaching out to publishers, reaching out to library accessibility experts and administration to talk about what it means for libraries, specifically in the context of higher education, to take on a leadership role with regard to accessibility. Open accessible content means that materials your organization decides to publish are accessible from the outset, making them open to everyone. So in other words, I'm talking about humane publishing practices to produce responsive books. Parallel discussions are currently happening about open access and accessibility, but I strongly believe that these two critical topics need to be taken in tandem as a part of the same discourse. What is open access if it's not open to all readers? And conversely, what is accessible if only to a small number of readers? Libraries have started to develop important strategies to accommodate users with print disabilities, but with concerns surrounding copyright limitations, these materials are only available to a select few. Open knowledge should be accessible to everyone. So this talk will focus on what if. I'm putting thoughts down on paper, and it's more of a reflective discussion. So what if we looked at open access and accessibility and scholarly communications as a part of the same discussion, by breaking down many of the seemingly arbitrary barriers that separate them? So feel free to jump in with questions if they are related to something that I just said or clarifying a point, but for more broad general questions, I would appreciate if you could hold on to them till the end. So I think that we have problems and they're not going away, and we being libraries. Institutions are struggling with a number of challenges in serving their readers, which revolve around sourcing quality materials at reasonable cost. As the soaring cost of publisher content continues to eat up budget dollars, the question of access and delivery and quality permeate many high-level discussions. How to square delivery costs and user satisfaction is a perennially vexing question, and inevitably concessions are made. Looking at the music industry, it has been experiencing a similar challenge with digital delivery in a way that is legal and discourages piracy. As Napster showed us, if users are presented with an option that is user-friendly, even if it breaks the law, then many are willing to take the chance. Although Napster was shut down, piracy and file sharing of music was out of the bag. Spotify and other music streaming services may be the answer to this. Major music labels have equity in Spotify, thereby investing in its future, which means the ease of access and royalties. This investment is making it work. Making the work benefit the corporations as well as the end users. We have to ask publishers, what are they invested in, and how they see working with us to further improve delivery and user engagement. Furthermore, what roles libraries can play in terms of self-publishing and how and what, I do apologize for the siren, there is a fire truck going by, and how and what we can do to complement or fill the gaps left in commercial publishing practices. Accessibility for digital content means two things: successful delivery of content, as in digital platforms, as well as the quality and responsiveness of this content. Web content accessibility guidelines, I'm sure most of you have heard of them by now or have been working directly with programmers around this, known as WCAG, W-C-A-G, provide guidelines for making digital content accessible by listing a series of considerations such as contrast, headings, adaptability to various technology devices, etc. So there's a lot of work that's happening with libraries in terms of making their web presence more accessible, and as well as digital repositories, improving navigation, discoverability of content. And in all honesty, this is something that all users can equally benefit from. We're not just developing something that is beneficial to a very small group. This is something that's useful for everyone. Libraries need to and want to offer accessible content, and ideally, not just on demand, but as a part of our normal collections. Patrons with print disabilities should not go to their library and have to ask for inclusive content and then wait to have to read it. They should select and access instantaneously based on their needs, just like everyone else. They should not go through the tedious process of verifying their disability. They should be able to select and read. So by verifying disability, I wanted to clarify, and for those of you who are not very familiar with processes that are in place at many institutions, when a student registers with the disability office in September, at the beginning of a course year, they have to, every September, provide current medical paperwork to attest to explain what their disability is. So this is already posing a huge challenge for international students, students who may be traveling out of state, out of province, who don't have access to their normal GP, their doctor, who understands their condition. And then furthermore, once they provide this paperwork, they have to have a little discussion with a disability counselor to review what options are available to them. Do they need quiet time to write exams? Do they qualify for accessible formats, and so on and so forth. So every single fall, each student, even if they registered the year before, has to complete this process. And I'm kind of familiar with that firsthand as well, since my husband, who is a librarian as well, is bilaterally hearing impaired. So he had to do this every single year, all throughout 8 years of his education. And it's a tedious process, and it's one that, for instance, in Canada, the human rights code is very much explicit that this is not necessary. There is a description and wording in terms of accommodation and good faith. And I strongly believe that libraries need to start moving in the direction of accommodation and good faith, because we need to make sure that we're not typecasting, we're not kind of collecting sensitive data, we're not screening our users, that we're here to provide something that is open and accessible to everyone. So in this context, our current way of doing things is rigid and arcane, and can be largely due to our delicate relationship with publishers, who in turn also live in trepidation of content walking freely on the internet. We need to collectively think and develop a strategy on working through these issues together. And a lot of this involves advocacy on behalf of libraries, speaking with publishers, channeling some of these issues, and kind of feeling out like what their feelings are and how we can advance past this together. Commercial content has a number of restrictions with regard to its usage, and that often gets in the way of serving our patrons. So, for instance, publishers are obviously very concerned about copyright infringement, which results in digital locks, further making materials inaccessible. Libraries have found ways of working around these restrictions by keeping track of copyright compliances and opening content to patrons on demand. But the landscape of managing commercial digital content is becoming increasingly complex and a huge drain on library resources. We have to be recognizant of that. New jobs are created to establish liaison roles to work with publishers, working through complex licensing deals and managing content that's been purchased, and it's becoming more and more complicated, I think, for both for libraries and publishers as well. So content that libraries could produce could actually be intended to walk freely on the internet, and educating not just members of our media communities, perhaps the elite few who can afford the soaring tuition fees, but reach thousands of other bright minds. The question then is, what impact would that have on content producers, on authors, our brilliant faculty, for instance? In the words of Loretta Lynn, her new album, everyone wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. And that really resonated with me. I think that's a very powerful statement. Scholars love the idea of their research reaching the maximum number of readers and stimulating critical thought. I think that's very important to them. But tenure practices require faculty to publish in prestigious journals, as well as financial incentives. They all prevent them from advancing forward towards opening their knowledge to wider audiences. This is a serious issue for higher education, as the rising cost of publisher content and issues related to perpetuity of access are not sustainable in the long term. In this larger context, libraries are beginning to question their roles in facilitating access to content. We need to step back and kind of reflect on our current roles. Many of these issues I have just highlighted fall on the library staff to solve. We want to make our collections accessible, and some of us are already investing in technologies and staff to take care of patron requests for responsive formats. However, it feels like a waste of time to take a digitally born book and make it accessible when we know it was born accessible before a digital lock, for instance, made it less usable. Breaking those locks makes a lot of people very nervous, even when acting on behalf of patrons with legitimate disability, in whichever way your institution chooses to verify what that legitimate disability is. So I think it would be very interesting to track instances of locks being removed, how many of them are being removed a year by each institution, which publishers, kind of documenting these practices. But I really understand, having discussed this broad idea with people in the community as well as copyright experts, there's a lot of hesitation to document this kind of thing, because there are legal issues around it. People are very nervous. Once you start documenting that you're breaking digital locks, there's evidence that you're doing that. And in turn, of course, you could get, you're becoming a target for a lawsuit. But on the other hand, if we're able to document this, if we're able to document how difficult it is to get in touch with publishers, to accommodate a patron in a timely manner, and how many digital locks get broken as a result of kind of you know, basically desperate staff looking for solutions in terms of accommodating their patrons, it could lead to a very interesting discussion with the publishing community in terms of sustainability in the long run. It's important for us to think about these two things as a part of the same conversation, open access and accessibility. As libraries are establishing their practices and standards of self-publishing, we should make sure that what we dream up is sustainable in the long run, and that we have an effective five-year plan and working towards concrete goals related to publishing. So the following kind of focuses on some important ideas for libraries to consider in order to move forward as leaders in inclusive content production. And these are my thoughts, some ideas that kind of were stimulated by attending the last year's Library Publishing Forum conference. And you know, feel free to jump in, or maybe you have better ideas. And I think having that discussion and focusing on these issues together, we could probably come up with really great solutions. So let's look at the current state of publishing as an opportunity to improve and reimagine what a digital book is. I highlighted some of the issues with regard to commercial publishing. And looking at in-house publishing, I think we have an opportunity to provide a high-quality publication. It's not a question of whether libraries should consider producing content in-house, but a matter of when we all do. We're all moving in that direction. It feels more intuitive to engage in self-publishing. So the question after that is, what will libraries produce and how will that product be different from commercial content? I think it's very important for us not to duplicate work that commercial publishers are already doing and reproduce kind of similar type of publications. We need to fill in, identify gaps and things that they can't deliver on and find a way to fill in those gaps. So the question of quality publication. A quality publication should provide library users with as many tools as possible. It could be assembled like Lego or molded like putty into a format of the reader's choice. So it has to be something flexible, a responsive book, which any library user can readily access and manipulate. It's challenging to produce something that everyone can use. So it has to be responsive. It has to be flexible content. So whether it has bells and whistles, whether it has in-text citations that students can use, or it's really, really stripped down to the basic. I think we have to let the readers, our students, faculty, staff, kind of decide how they want to access this content, in what format. Do they want those add-ons? Do they want super basic publications? There are initiatives such as the British Columbia's Open Textbook Project, where we can learn a great deal from. And I included a link on the screen. So one of the goals of this project was to provide a flexible and affordable access to higher education resources in BC by making available openly licensed textbooks in the highest enrolled academic subject area. The second phase was just announced in spring of 2014 to add at least 20 textbooks targeting trades and skills training. These open textbooks are openly licensed using a Creative Commons license and are offered in various ebook formats free of charge. Or print-on-demand books are also available at cost. And I think the print-on-demand option is something that should always be made available because some people, like myself perhaps, absorb information much better when it's in print format. This project is an amazing glimpse into what our publishing practices could look like. So I strongly encourage everyone to have a look at it. I think it's important to focus also on the issue of legitimacy. How would content created by libraries rank on par with publisher content in terms of quality? And how would our roles as publishers differ from the commercial sector? For instance, what many scholars find appealing about the publishing in prestigious journals is the rigorous peer review process each article has to go through. It acknowledges the legitimacy of content as accurate, valuable scholarship, and the prestige is reflected back upon the author. The high-quality publication libraries should look to produce should involve some type of peer-reviewed process for open access content. We need to think about what this process would look like. where that funding would come from, who would be involved in it, how to make this process more democratic, because publishing in open access, you know, is fantastic, but we want to make sure that it is quality publication that's coming through. So quality of content also means that readers can interact with books in their preferred way. I talked about publications being very flexible and responsive. And what does that mean? My personal thoughts are perhaps that we could find a way to build responsive platforms that house very flexible content that would set us apart from many publishers who are still not able to get on board with accessibility. And it's not, I don't want to sound negative, it's not that publishers don't want to have anything to do with developing accessible content, but there are, it's perhaps not a huge priority for many commercial publishers. A, there's no, subsidized funding for doing this. B, maybe libraries are not pushing hard enough in terms of advocating on behalf of, you know, our readers and saying, this is kind of the direction in which we're moving, and it's beginning to cost us more and more and more converting commercial books into accessible formats. But also maybe there's not enough awareness. So again, advocacy, we need to talk more about this, and we need to create opportunities to speak with publishers about. So thinking further about our opportunities, let's look at the online environment. We have an opportunity to create something that thrives in the digital world. It is cost-effective and responsive. I think it's important to reflect on how we can learn from our diverse users who access our ebooks and how libraries can become the online places for readers, superseding Amazon and Google Books. Can our books interact with one another online? Can our users use digital books as gateways to connect with a of related resources and maybe their readers as well? We should not limit ourselves in terms of our possibilities, such as looking at user-generated content or citations and archiving that material as well. Another important consideration is economic sustainability, of course. The key incentive for authors to contribute important scholarship to open access is knowing that their work will reach the widest audience possible. Equating open access with access to users of all abilities will ensure just that. More research councils are starting to require scholarship published with their grant funds to be open access. So last year, three of the major Canadian granting agencies, the Canadian Institute of Health Research, the Natural Sciences and Engineering Research Council of Canada, and the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada, implemented an open access policy requiring publications stemming from their grants to be open access. This is a big breakthrough for us. In their official statement on this policy, the agency suggested that regardless of funding, all researchers should ensure that their publications are open access. So I'm just thinking how we can build this into our complex bureaucracies, turning our current practices around and making open access the new norm as opposed to a special discussion. Furthermore, what is our individual role in contributing valuable scholarship to this new global library of open accessible knowledge? I think we should also think about preserving content across formats. So producing sustainably means producing materials that can be preserved effectively and converted into multiple formats in the future. XML can generate just about any format, be it Word or an EPUB, which can then interact with any assistive technologies a user might employ. We need to make sure that our conversation preservation experts are pulled into these discussions from the very beginning, helping us create content which has longevity in terms of technology and compatibility and users. And these are discussions which are taking place with Internet Archive folks as well. I had the pleasure of attending one of their leadership forums last year, and the last one we had a representation coming in from one of our accessibility groups at Ontario Council of University Libraries to represent work that we do. And I think it's very important to continue pushing for this and sharing our knowledge and kind of establishing this community of practice where we are able to act in the capacity of advisors and provide them with our feedback and feedback that we receive from our users. So definitely a very big discussion happening around kind of planning for the future and preservation and how to kind of what formats we should focus on producing. And then setting standards. I think we need to think about what an accessible book is. There are many guides and toolkits available online that will walk you through how to create an accessible format or convert a print book into an OCR. OCR is optical character recognition, for those of you who are not familiar with the acronyms, PDF. So it would be much better if we created inclusive learning materials from the beginning, as opposed to creating something that we know will need extra work in order to make it accessible. And consortia have a tremendous power in establishing these kinds of future-forward practices that are easily adopted across the continent. Setting standards related to publishing formats, metadata, and discoverability will improve the quality of research outputs in North America. We should also think about the value of working with global initiatives such as WIPOs, the World Intellectual Property Organization, Accessible Consortium, or ABC. And the ABC is a multi-stakeholder partnership comprising of WIPO, organizations that serve people with print disabilities, and organizations representing publishers and authors. We also have organizations like the Association of Research Libraries, with which I've worked this past year, which has an enormous and very impressive list of partnerships and working relationships, and which is very deeply committed to accessibility. On the local level, we have consortia like the Ontario Council of University Libraries, the Atlantic Provinces Library Association, or even more broadly, the Association of American University Presses. There are a lot of interested stakeholders who could be a part of this larger discourse. And I think we should think about collaborating across the border between Canada and the United States and thinking kind of in the long term how we can maximize like our resources and what we can do together to develop these practices. We also need to look at publishing openly accessibly as a learning opportunity. So currently accessibility services and libraries seeking to secure accessible format materials for their users have to find creative solutions in doing so, as not every publisher has an explicit policy with regard to accommodation. And just because I kind of felt like doing it, I went on a couple of websites to commercial publishing sites to have a look at, you know, to see if I can find very explicit accessibility statements, statement of commitment to accessibility, policies, anything with regard to providing accessible formats. And it can be extremely difficult even finding that information. Looking for publisher contact, you know, who is that point person with whom we could have that discussion, who is aware of accessibility practices, who could provide an accessible format. In many instances, it's impossible to find that information. So at the very basic, I think we need to encourage our partners, our publishing partners, to make that information more visible and have a list of contacts that we can deal with. Because if a patron requests materials in accessible format, they often have to wait a period of time while library staff determine the most effective way to source that material. It can be very, very hard. This could involve contacting publishers to find out if accessible format is available. Failing that, maybe looking for the title via other services like Bookshare, or a service that I run through Scholars Portal is called Accessible Content ePortal or ACE, or producing this file in-house, just scanning a book or a couple of chapters and then OCRing it. So libraries that produce their own publications can easily build accessibility into their sustainability plans, developing platforms that are easy to navigate and content that's technology friendly for everyone. In cases where accessible texts are required to be delivered in a timely manner, such as required by, for instance, Ontario's accessibility legislation, this can ensure that these requirements are easily met. If you are your own boss, it's easy to respond to issues in an effective way. If your level of accessibility has been reported as troubling, you can fix the issue yourself without having to communicate these concerns to a third-party vendor. If publishers can always support the production of inclusive learning materials, libraries as leaders in information should step away from their supporting role and into leadership shoes, pushing for open access and preservation of flexible and accessible information resources for users of all abilities, and hopefully along the way, bringing publishing costs down. So I have some concluding remarks and thoughts. I think libraries are known to what our role is. We are here to facilitate access to knowledge, and this is what we do in the most simplistic terms. So this facilitation is definitely becoming increasingly complex with complicated publisher package deals, leading institutions to develop license usage tracking systems to stay on top of what they can and cannot do with materials they buy. These are often very complicated solutions with too many stakeholders and many steps involved, requiring a great deal of resources invested to essentially manage products we have supposedly paid to own. This is further complicated in the context of transforming formats into accessible materials to support our users with print disabilities. In many instances, library staff need to contact publishers to secure permission to transform formats, a process which can take weeks and sometimes yield ineffective results if no one writes back. However, I'm not saying that we don't need commercial publishers. At least I'm not saying that yet. But we need to start thinking about sustainability of our practices as well as the value of knowledge. A printed book could cost $39.99 at a local bookstore, or $16 on the Amazon. So my question for you is, what is the intrinsic value to us in digital format, and how much or how little are we prepared to pay for it, and what is reasonable? If libraries produce their own open and accessible content, we will very suddenly find that our existing resources, such as budgets and staff, can be used more productively to help us become and maintain the role of leaders in advancing digital publishing by bringing equilibrium to the representation of content creator and readers' interests. Libraries have the opportunity to adopt humane publishing practices and develop content which is open and responsive. Tackling the worldwide issue of book famine, citing that only 7% of published materials available in accessible formats, that's very, very little. The Marrakesh Treaty is close to coming into force as the number of countries requiring to ratify is nearing 20, which is what the requirement is. So this has the potential to significantly change the landscape regarding the production and dissemination of accessible text. A small but significant provision in the treaty allows for import and export of accessible text, which could open up a significant global market. Supply and demand could dictate the outsourcing of accessible text production. So commercial publishers could be monetizing their own product by making accessible books open for sale. And this is currently definitely an area of opportunity for libraries who self-publish. This is an area which is still fluid, and there are a lot of stakeholders who have a chance to take a leadership role to redefine the world of digital publishing. So that's the end of my talk today. I would love to have some questions, or I'm very happy to take if you are in a rush or if you have ideas or thoughts following this webinar. I'm super happy to receive a tweet from you, or if you wanted to email me, my email address is on the screen. It's katya@scholarsportal.info, or alternatively Twitter at @sociallibrarian.
Well, thank you so much, Katya. That was a very, very inspiring talk that you just gave. I have a couple of questions to get us started. One is quite practical, and the other is a little bit more lofty. My first practical question is, do you have a recommended format that we as library publishers could use as our base so that we can easily and quickly translate that to a variety of accessible formats? Do you have a recommendation for us? So that's my practical question. And then my more lofty question is, you mentioned a lot of different organizations. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if you see that one of them is a natural leader to bring all of these stakeholders together to develop standards and common practices or platforms that we as library publishing publishers could use. So those are my two questions that are quite different.
Great. Oh, those are actually very good questions. Thank you, Kate. So Bookshare worked with WIPO in this last year. And before I left on mat leave, I was given a copy of their kind of rough draft document, basically outlining standards for accessible production, publishing production. And I'm not 100% sure whether or not that guide has been published yet, but definitely I see WIPO, the ABC group, as well as the Bookshare, are being very proactive in the area of kind of defining standards and working with commercial publishers. So I would keep a close eye on what they're doing. In terms of formats, I mentioned during my presentation that XML format is very flexible. You can generate Word from it. You can generate pretty much anything. Discussions that we've had with Internet Archive in this last year was around the issue of like formats, which currently they produce EPUB, they produce text files. So we wanted to get together and kind of reflect a little bit more on what's kind of planning for the future, what formats are reasonable to continue producing, should they move past EPUB into something else. So I think Internet Archive will also be very, very helpful as a leader in accessibility, because these are discussions they're very interested in. They dedicate a lot of their staff time to exploring issues of accessible web design. They launched a new website. There was a lot of investment in making it more responsive. So I definitely see Internet Archive as being another leader in accessibility as well.
Thank you. Melanie wrote to the group a question for you. She first gave you a thank you. Your discussion of the changing nature of books and opportunities for libraries in that area was interesting. Thanks. Then she said, much of the content libraries publish is serial publications delivered through standard platforms such as OJS and Digital Commons. Library publishers also tend to publish lots of reprints and other non-born digital content. Do you have ideas for how we can make improvements in these areas, even incremental ones?
I know that, for instance, where I work, Scholars Portal, is also doing a lot of work with OGS and kind of working with these platforms. I think what we need to focus on is what we're doing locally, how that fits into a more like international scene, and how it complements what other institutions are doing. But we can't lose sight of producing, making sure that what we're producing, first of all, benefits our user group, right? So I'm not sure if that answers the question, but I think on a more practical level, we first have to serve our immediate community. So the type of content that we're producing has to meet those needs, and that's going to be different from one institution to another.
Does anyone else have a question for Katya?
I also wanted to add that I do have a script of the notes, my speaking notes. I understand that this will be published on YouTube, but if for those of you who work better with notes as opposed to audio, I'm very happy to share them.
All right. Unless somebody jumps in while I'm doing the closing, I'm going to once again say thank you very much to Katya. And I wanted to give a couple reminders. The first is the Library Publishing Forum is coming up May 17th through the 19th. So I'm sure you've all got your calendars marked for that, but just a reminder. And then also the Library Public Publishing Coalition is going to be supporting another webinar that's coordinated by the Professional Development Committee in May. On May 24th, Kevin Smith will be talking about author agreements, and that will be the link for that will be sent out probably in the beginning of May. So watch your inbox for that. As Katya said, this has been recorded and it will be distributed, so watch the list for that. And also watch your email for a feedback form that we will be sending out via email to all the participants. So if you have feedback about this session or ideas, especially ideas for future webinars, we are very happy to hear those. Any last second for questions? All right. Well, thank you so much, Katya, for sharing your vision and your very widespread knowledge about all the organizations and work going on in this area. And wanted to thank you. Thank you again.
Thank you very much, folks, for inviting me to speak.
All right. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you in May.